strip it down back to what you know you can do, what you know you can do well, and fucking do it and get better at it.
Bonjour.
What are you doing? I've not been told there was any media today. This was my day. I am not happy about this. Where is my manager? Is it makeup? Get out of my face.
Okay, my little lovelies, who've been freaking the fuck out because you've seen two videos in MMA gym, and now you think, we're never going back to the gym. So today we're back in the gym. And a lot of you have been talking about how I'm gonna balance doing the MMA training with weight training, like how am I gonna still keep it in line with each other. And that's what we're gonna go through today. So we're gonna be going in and we're gonna be going through some compound movements. So we're doing some squats. I'm gonna start, literally today, start doing some deadlifting. Now, I've never deadlifted properly before on a consistent basis. I've done it for like 2-3 months at a time, then backed off for whatever reason. I used to believe years ago that it used to thicken your waist, which is a reason I never started doing it, which annoys me now that I know that that's nonsense. But hey, we all fall for myths at some point in life because we're all human. You need to be doing your compounds. Worry more about your compounds than you do about isolations, because isolations develop way less than any compound will do. Your compounds will see you through for life, your isolations will see you through for the pump. As I said before, when you saw last time, we were going to the MMA gym, and in terms of what I used before I go, so I've had creatine this morning already, 5 grams, like I said. What is it? Where is my one? Basically, don't get sold on crazy creatine like promises. It's creatine's good, so just get a creatine mono. That's the one I use. You've seen it loads on here. It's the Create8. The big word that you need to look for is the word is micronized. Yeah. It says it on there somewhere. Anyway, micronized is the one you want to get if you're going to get a creatine, because it mixes super easy. So it just makes life easier. When we went to MMA, we went with a non-pump stim and focus. Now, I don't need that this morning. I feel fine. I'm gonna have a coffee and I feel awake, so I don't need the stims. I don't need them. So don't take stimulants just because it's become a habit. You don't wanna become reliant on anything that gets you into the gym, because you're using it as a crutch. So the moment that you don't have that to hand, you're gonna feel like, even before you get in the gym, you're gonna feel like you're gonna have a bad session. That's not what you want. Whenever you take something, it needs to elevate you above an already positive state. That's how you need to be thinking. So the moment you feel like you need something to go to the gym, stop taking it. Stop going to the gym without it deliberately, just to prove to yourself you do not need that stuff, okay? But the difference today is we're gonna be using this one. So this is the PSI. Now this is a vasodilator, no stimulants in it whatsoever. So you've got beta-alanine and then you've got arginine. So the alanine's great for building stamina over time, but then the arginine is the thing that gives you that pump. So no stimulants, but still gonna get something that's gonna help push blood through into the muscles, which is good now, because yesterday I went and did like hella 2 hours of wrestling and rolling and throwing. So I'm pretty stiff and sore. And so I want to get that blood flowing to the muscles quickly. That's what that's gonna help do. Also, because I've been doing so much kind of cardio side with the biting, this should react really, really well, because I haven't taken it for like 3-4 days. So again, that's the benefit of it. If you don't take it for a long time, when you do, you get those original benefits that you first saw when you started taking it. That's pretty much it for today. So we will spin.
I'm not going to spin.
No.
Not this time, because we're about to go into a cinematic edit of the gym and I can't necessarily spin into it because it's going to have music instead of going whoosh.
Once we've left the gym, we're going to spin to a coffee shop. We could have spun to the gym.
No, because
you'll have seen pretty stuff out the gym before we came here. All right, well, I'm gonna spin.
That is what I'm gonna
call. Anyway, right, so we're back in Coliseum, back in the home. I'm gonna warm up now. I'm gonna go into squats. I'm gonna be doing 3 or 4 sets of working sets. Gonna do a lot of warming, though, because it's still a little bit cold. I know I'm in a t-shirt and shorts, so it's warm enough to kind of be in here. And that, ideally, really, though, I wanted to put another layer over the top.
at least we forgot to grab one before we left the house. We're going to warm up, then we're going to squat. Then from the squat, we're going to go to the bench. And then from the bench, we're going to go to deadlifts. And I'm going to break it up like that because then I'm going lower, upper, and then doing the compound of a dead, which is kind of lower and upper together. So what I don't want to do is go from the squat straight to a dead because it put a lot of stress on the lower back. I'm going to be honest with you, probably 3 weeks. 3 weeks, I don't think I've been in here doing compounds because obviously I got man flu, which turned into real flu. And when I was in here, I was not lifting heavy stuff. So I very much expect that I will not be able to hit the weights that I was hitting 3-4 weeks ago when I was doing these compounds. So I'm not going to let that bother me. What I'm bothered about here is the technique, the focus, and setting the weight correctly and lifting it correctly. Whether you're lifting 90 kilograms or 190 kilograms, all we want is that overload point with good technique.
Oh, Jesus.
I'm opening up all my body because when you squat, obviously you're putting the bar behind here and you're holding it there. So if you're tight or on your chest, chances are you're not going to be able to keep the bar sat back deep. You're going to have a tendency to rock forward. The more you can open up your body, the more supple it is, the easier it's going to sit down into the position you need. And the big fault with most squatters, and I used to do it myself, is leaning forward with the body. You see it all the time. They come like, they lower the bar by lowering your upper body and not by dropping the hips.
Right, so stretching, warming up, mobility, massive, massive part of hitting your compounds properly. I used to be notorious for coming in, like, I'd do a couple of hamstring stretches, stretch my quads off and jump straight in. So I wasn't opening up my hips, I wasn't setting my body, wasn't setting the range of motion, nothing. So the more you train your body into the movement you're about to do, the easier it will be and the quicker you'll get better at it. Spend 10-15 minutes, I know it's boring, but do it. Spend 10-15 minutes just warming up, doing all your mobility stuff. I think there's a squat mobility video I've done on the channel. If I find it, I'll put a link in the description for you. So look in there and we go through all the warm-ups in detail about what to do. But most people struggle connecting the load on the bar to the muscles they should be working. What they think is if they move it from point A to point B, like they see in the picture, then it'll do the job, and that's not how it works. You have to be able to move it from point A to point B using the muscles that you should be focusing on. The saying I have is, don't shift it, lift it.
I actually felt all right. Definitely doing the mobilities helped. I'm super, super tight in all my hip flexor kind of groin area, which I expected to kind of be because I'm doing such much more dynamic movement with the MMA that I'm tightening up in places that haven't been utilized in certain angles for a long time. So I expected that. It's something that what I didn't expect was it to feel quite as nice as it did. Admittedly, there's only a light weight on here at the moment, but that's exactly what you need to be doing. When something feels like it might be a little bit off, don't push it. Go straight in with something you can control and that you can easily place the load, so you can move the load around without risking injuring yourself. So that with this, I can get to the bottom of a rep and shift a little bit, and I'm no risk of popping anything. Whereas if I had like two plates on the side and I shifted at the bottom of the rep or went out of alignment, then you're risking hurting yourself. So as I'm here under the bar, what I'm looking for here is I'm gonna squeeze my glutes in, bam, so my glutes are activated. You can see that almost rolls my knees out. At the same time, rolling my knees out. So not being here and going in, I'm squeezing the glutes and rolling the knees, and you can see it, bam. There we go. And then from there, I'm pulling down on the bar, big breath in, brace my core, and down. And the big point here is when I get to the bottom, I don't disconnect. What a lot of people do is they get down, and when they get down, they forget everything they just locked in at the top and let everything go loose, and then they come kind of back up by any means necessary. That's when you start getting forward leans. That's when you start getting knee pressure because the weight displaces and moves forward. So remember, the rep doesn't finish until you get back up to the top. Keep everything locked in and tight, and when you get to the bottom, you stop and you come back up with the exact same body lock as you had going down. That is the main place people fail, the base of the rep. So if I had an ego right now, I'd be pulling this off, I'd be slamming another 20 plate on there, I'd be banging the weights together. No, I've got a 10. I've got the little baby weight. Because I do what I gotta do to get better, not to look better in the eyes of others who really don't matter to me. Last one! the focus is going to be like kind of that 5 to 8 rep range. Stop at least one before failure, or if you're just getting back into it, do 5-6 reps, put it down, and save your energy for the next set, so you're maintaining the technique and the focus. Then in that theory, if you stick with that, you should be able to up the weight a little bit more than you would if you're going to failure every set. Fancy and pretty to look at. I have been through this before, but I'm coming back from an actual glute tear back into squatting. So I've basically started from as if I'd never squatted, because I've had to rehab completely from the ground up. And if I'm honest, I don't think I ever really squatted properly before in terms of technique and knowing what I'm doing until the video I did with Omar, which again is on the channel. Omar helped reset my squat, and since then it's the only time I truly believe I've squatted properly. So, effectively, I'm starting from ground zero. So, progression for me on this, in any form, just even in the fact that the technique feels better, that I'm able to control it better, that I'm able to lift more smoothly, that's all progression. That is all progression. It doesn't always, progression isn't always about the weight, I've said it before. It's about improvement. Have a good playlist when you're training. Search Lex Griffin on Spotify. Fuck shit up, but it's not spelled fuck shit up. It's like hit that rock music when that beat drops, or something that makes you feel fucking alive inside because you've got memories. I promise you now, you will get an extra 1-2 reps or an extra set.
First of all, I was raised like, don't be a bitch, work as hard as you can, and no one gives a f-.
Warming and building up, setting the technique, locking it in. What we're looking for here is we're looking to press with wrists in line with the elbows, not flaring, rolling the shoulders back and setting the scapula, and then contracting our lats. And as you come down, keeping your scapula retracted, chest up, you're gonna squeeze your glutes, and you're gonna drive back up without letting the shoulders pop forward. This is the main thing people do wrong on the bench, is they overextend. But the moment you release the shoulder, you're displacing the load, which number one, you're taking away from your potential, but two, you're also risking injuring the rotator cuff, scapula, shoulder. Tears can happen in the pec because you're loading and deloading in a really rapid fashion, rather than holding the posture. Be consistent and technical. Don't let the ego on compounds take hold, because when you're doing something lightweight and isolation or something like that, and you do something a little bit wrong, the chances of hurting yourself are very low. But when you're shifting certain amounts of weight that are above the ability of the stabilizing muscles to control, that's when you're risking injury. So this is where you really have to drop the ego, lift what you can lift, and lift it well. Lift it, don't shift it. Also, happy feet. So what you'll see a lot of people do when they're benching is they're tapping the feet on the floor, doing this, or moving their feet around. Everything, this should be planted. You drive through your heels, so you squeeze your glutes, you drive, you push through your heels, and drive through your palms, keeping your shoulders pinned back. So it's that, as if you're setting a base below the entirety of the weight to drive up through. So if you see your partner, or you feel that your feet are moving, there's something wrong that needs correcting. So watch when I set up under the bar. I start a bit behind the bar, I slide myself in, and what I do, and then I set my heels down. I've got an arch in my lower back, chest is up, I roll my scapula back, keep it engaged. When you're lifting the bar off, really, really try and not release the shoulders. The trick is to really try and keep those shoulders pinned and lift off, and as you lift off, pull those lats in. And then we're gonna drive through heels, keeping those shoulders down and back. Oh, and head down.
You're the only one that can fix that. Dude, this is all I f***ing have right now. Like, I gotta make this so I can make my f***ing wife's life better, so I can do what I want. Like, this is, I have to do this. I have to do this. I have to do this. I have to do this.
I'm gonna say now, I'm not I've no intent or no desire to be a powerlifter. What I just want to do is get better at them and get stronger as a result of getting better at them. But I don't have a set weightlifting goal like some people do. So, I mean, if powerlifting really interests you, obviously you need to have a really structured incremental routine on these. But for me, I just set a baseline and I'm gonna be coming in each week and at least every time minimum hit that baseline and then slowly edge those weights up so that my final weights slowly become heavier and heavier over time. The biggest things that will hold you back is your own perception of yourself. The biggest thing. So strip it down back to what you know you can do, what you know you can do well, and fucking do it and get better at it. And it'll, you'll see real improvement then. What is the point in me here? Like, I could put 2.5 plates on here and move it badly. It'll still move from top to bottom, but it's not really working what it should be. It's just doing those two pictures that you see in an instruction pamphlet, start point, end point. But what matters is the whole part in between. On it then, 90 was it? Yeah, so we put it down. So we're up to 100, 24, yeah, 100. We're up to 100 on the bar, which is 220 pounds, that's right, isn't it? Yeah, so 220 pounds, 100 kilograms on the bar now. On that 90, my body, I don't know if you've been able to see, was really shaking because like the stabilizers haven't been used for a few weeks, so they weren't locking in as tight as they should be. So what I'm going to do now is, I know I can move the weight like quite okay, but what I'm not going to do is overload the stabilizer. So I'm only going to
stop moving the bar, I'm leaning on it.
Cheek. This is my show. So what I'm gonna do is aim for like 3 or 4 reps. So I know I can get those, but that's not gonna do is it's not gonna overload the stabilizers, meaning that my technique loses focus. Because most of the time, the reason your technique goes is because the stabilizing muscles, the supporting muscles, they lose their ability to maintain your posture. The big muscle group you're working is able to move the weight, and that's why you end up kind of cheating the rep, because the big muscles can move it, but the smaller ones, they begin to fail. So when they fail, that's overload. That's failure, you're done. What I'm gonna do now is also take the t-shirt off, not for vanity reasons, but simply because skin grips better to the bench on here. The skin on that PVC or leather, whatever the hell it is, will grip better. So what I found is when I'm driving, I'm losing my posture a bit because the t-shirt is slipping on the bench. You can actually put chalk on the top and the back across your back of your shoulders, and that'll help you grip to the bench as well. So this will come off now to do this, but it's not warm enough to keep it off. So the moment off this, t-shirt goes back on. Let's go! Deadlifting. Now, I've never done this, as I said before, so I'm pretty sure I'll suck in terms of the amount I can pull. But what I'm aware of is how the form kind of needs to be. We're now in a time where powerlifting and stuff like that has never, never, never been more popular, and it's fucking amazing because powerlifting has been an underrated sport for far, far too long. Because it is fucking incredible what those guys do. In terms of that becoming more popular and more mainstream, it also means that a lot of you guys are getting into it and getting excited about it. But you have to understand, powerlifting, strength training is nothing like bodybuilding. You can get hurt. And I'm not talking about, oh, put my back out. I mean like herniated discs, like serious, bad long-term injuries can occur from one moment of stupidity. So if you are going and thinking about doing powerlifting, you are doing it now, please don't treat it like bodybuilding where you just go in and go ham. Be careful, research your form, video yourself, have your spotters check you. When they say something's wrong, don't take it as an offense, fucking listen and change and adjust. Pull back if you need to. So what if you don't hit that PR for another 2 weeks? Would you not rather hit that PR properly? Lift it, don't shift it, remember. I'm not gonna be lifting a lot of weight today. What I'm gonna be doing is seeing where I'm at, how I feel, what my form looks like. Now, if you look at where we are, this is a temporary deadlift area. So it's not the best.
okay? Ideally, what you want is a hard floor. This is fine. This is a bit spongy, so like, it's not gonna be bad today because I'm not gonna be pulling a lot of weight, but if I was pulling a lot of weight, that flooring would be no good because it would buckle underneath me. So make sure that you're on a rigid floor when you are lifting, if you're pulling good weight, heavy weight. And I mean heavy for you, not for the guy next to you. Heavy for you, heavy for your body. So what you want to look into when you are deadlifting is you want to try and keep the bar close to the body. One of the main things that a lot of people tend to allow happen and they don't realise is letting the bar swing outward. And that's a really bad thing because what you need to do is you kind of need to keep the weight moving in a straight line. And the moment you let a bar swing out, you're displacing the weight forward. And that's what's going to pull your shoulders forward, which is going to then round your back. So we want to keep the weight close in tight to the body, which is why you'll see people wearing the shin guards. The real idea is to drag the bar up your shins. And that's why this part of the bar here doesn't have grip on it. So when we're in front of the bar, I've got the bar right by my shins. Now, when I reach down to get the bar, you want to reach down quite naturally. So you're gonna kick your hips back a little bit and just reach down to where the bar is. Now, the main thing a lot of people try and do is try and go too deep too early. If you can't, like a lot of people try and sit before they go down. A lot of people try and like think they need to sit in here before they go. If your comfortable start point is here, that's where you start. Because the worst thing you can do is have your hips fire early. That's what we want to avoid. So anything that we can do to control our hips. And what I mean by hips firing early is, when I start to pull, rather than my upper body moving like this, up nice and concentrically, what'll happen is, you'll see people, is their hips go bump, and then they pull with the upper body. And that's where you get a load of the lower back stress and you start rounding. So what we're looking to have is a pull that is nice and solid, so the chest stays up, and we drive, bam, through, and then squeeze through hips, glutes, everything squeezing through. What we don't want is this. Hips pop, boom, and then lift. Like a straight leg deadlift. Sit down, pull yourself into the bar. So you pull yourself in to wherever feels comfortable. For me, it'd be here. And then what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna load the weight onto my heels. I'm gonna keep my chest up, my shoulders back, lats engaged. So I'm pulling into the bar, and then I'm gonna drive up. I'm gonna start like push up through the quads and the heels. Then as I get to here, then I'm gonna fire my hips through, squeeze my glutes, and really push my chest through. So it looks kind of like this. See what I mean? And then when I'm bringing it back down, what I'm not doing is coming down and then going up and over the knees. It comes down past the knees and then drops in. And this can be a bit awkward to get, but it is quite a natural motion. If you find that your knees are in the way when you're coming down, it's because you're not allowing your hips to kick back enough to clear them out of the way. So when you're coming back down, you need to be keeping the hips back to clear that space. If you're not, it means you're bending at the knees and not putting the hips back. You want your shoulders slightly in front of the bar, for me anyway, slightly in front of the bar if I'm in line, because then that gives me a leverage point. If my shoulders are in line with the bar, I'm taking away that lever point of the hips. If at any point during the movement you go wrong, stop and reset. The biggest thing that you can do, stop and reset things. It might be really, really infuriating, it might be really frustrating, you might need to do it every 2 reps. So what? In 6 months you won't need to, but you'll be deadlifting properly, you'll be benching properly, you'll be squatting properly. And that long term will benefit you for life, rather than short term benefit your ego by shifting, you know, weight badly. And if you get that all right, it should flow fine. But the main point would be, don't try and lift too much too early. I've got to learn all this myself again. I've got to go through all this. So I know the rough points, but even I've got to learn this. So as I learn more things, as I find errors of what I do, please, you know, point them out for when I go through these over time. A lot of you guys are really good at helping with deadlifts. Again, we've gone through some deadlifting before in the video, so check back. I did one with Max Tuning where he explains a deadlift. Everybody back up! I want this! I want this! I want this! I'm bigger than a back truck! I want this! I want this! Everybody back up! I want this! I want this! See, even then, I could feel my hips firing a little bit early on that. So I corrected it about four in, and immediately the movement felt shorter. There was less movement overall, because if I'm moving my hips early, I'm going like one, two. Whereas if you come up properly, it's just like, oh, there already. See what I mean? So if you feel like the movement's really long, there's probably your hips firing a little bit early. Watch out, watch out.
down. Pop, 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 get, 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 watch out. Pop, 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 pop.
It's Rob Bailey, Bailey.
What I found was a real limitation for me was grip strength. Some people just have that dad grip, I call it, where they've got really strong grip. I don't have it. And as much as I like to try and train it, there is a point where my grip becomes my limiting factor. And a lot of you will be the same. At that time, start using wraps, straps, whatever, to lift that weight, because don't sacrifice the other benefits you can get from lifting that weight using something to support your grip. There's no point in limiting your back growth, your potential of increasing your deadlift, because your grip's letting you down. So the three plates on here now, which I'm quite impressed with, because I've not deadlifted in, I couldn't even tell you when, but I'm using over under grip. But if you do use over under, make sure that you're not rotating your body. So be really careful, make sure that you're setting your scapula back, balancing your shoulders. So if you've got spotters again, make them look at you. Make them look at you from the side, from the back, and make sure you're not rotating or twisting off from one side to the other. Symmetry is important. With that, I hope we covered a lot of the basics there for your compound stuff in terms of your frame of thought and where you need to be when you're doing these things. Just remember, all we're looking for is progression. Progression by any means, not weights don't dictate progression. You know, the results that you see in the mirror is progression. The fact that you're able to improve the way you lift something is progression. And if you get that in your head, stop comparing yourself to other people. Only, it's so cheesy, but it is you versus you. And not in terms of, you know, shouting yourself in the mirror, in terms of, what did I do when I was last in here? What went wrong? What could be improved? How do I improve it? That's the big, big point. Start researching how you improve things. Don't just, like, I try and answer as many questions as I can on here. Honestly, I truly do. I go through the comments, I read them, and I try and help and answer. But I want you guys to help each other. I know there's a lot of you on here that are deadlifting and that are very good at it. So please help people who ask questions about deadlifts, squats, benching. I know there's a lot of you on here that do powerlifting and stuff like that. And your advice will probably do more than you ever know. That one paragraph that you might write that may take you 10, 15 minutes might entirely change someone's training routine for the better. You might save somebody from really hurting themselves or maybe even quitting the gym because they don't feel like they're getting anywhere. What we do on here as a family, we are. You guys support me, and hopefully I support you in return, but you can support each other. We develop a community here, a place where you can come, ask a question, no matter how silly you think it is, and get a legitimate answer. I want you, like I've always said, to be able to watch my videos, enjoy them, but also take what you see and go and implement it straight away. That's my promise to you. Videos that you watch will always have something in it you can take and use then and there. Every single time, I promise you that's what we're gonna keep doing. That is the goal of this series. The dedicated series isn't all about the gym or an MMA class or boxing or something so specific. It's about the mentality. It's about how to get through things. It's about how to think, about how to progress in real terms, how to create real change in your life, both in the gym, outside of the gym, in new ventures, to try new ventures. The amount of people who were insanely positive about me going back to MMA was fantastic, but there was that select small percentage of people that were fighting the change. I remember someone put, I have no interest in MMA, don't forget about the gym. And immediately I thought, I mean, it doesn't bother me that, whatever, you don't like the MMA video. If you didn't like it, fair enough, that's your opinion. But to immediately shut an entire sport or an entire avenue of learning out, and to just blink at yourself like that, is a really, really bad mentality to have. Because I promise you now, if you're doing that with that one thing, you're definitely doing it in other parts of your life. So don't be like that. Don't just look here. Let everything from the outside in. Take what you love, follow it and learn it. Try something new if you don't like it, and don't carry it on, but at least you tried. So that's it for this one. I'll see you in the next episode. Thanks for watching. Make sure to hit the, where's the ding? Ding?
Ding? Like.
Click like. Bell. Thumbs up. Hit the notification bell. Subscribe down there so that you're not missing the videos in case YouTube decides to do something stupid. Once again, thanks for all the love and support. Make sure you comment below with any questions. If you don't answer, please help. And I'll catch you in the next one. Lex out.